Good evening, everyone. As we come now to worship today, we celebrate Christ's resurrection. And as we draw towards the evening, may the joy of the day and these words and music which we are about to hear quieten our souls, still our minds, and give peace in our hearts. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore, I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying, after me. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Grant, we beseech thee, merciful Lord, to thy faithful people pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve thee with a quiet mind through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We say together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. O Lord, open thou our lips, and our mouth shall show forth thy praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Praise ye the Lord. The Lord's name be praised.
Psalm 118, verses 14 to 24. The Lord is my strength and my song, and has become my salvation. The voice of joy and health is in the dwellings of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord bringeth mighty things to pass. The right hand of the Lord hath the preeminence. The right hand of the Lord bringeth mighty things to pass. I shall not die, but live, and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord hath chastened and corrected me, but he hath not given me over unto death. Open me the gates of righteousness, that I may go into them, and give thanks unto the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, the righteous shall enter into it. I will thank thee, for thou hast heard me, and art become my salvation. The same stone which the builders refused is become the headstone in the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvellous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The first lesson is taken from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, beginning at verse 34. Then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Here ends the first lesson.
The second lesson is taken from the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 20, beginning at the first verse. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside of the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus says, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Here ends the second lesson.
ever one God, world without end. Amen. O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Delighted that this Easter I'm able to bring Easter greetings to you all, and I do so in the traditional words that will be re-echoing around our churches today and will be reverberating across the world and come down to us through the centuries. The wonderful words, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Just recently I heard a story about a British soldier in 1944 who was serving in Normandy. And as they sensed the end of the war was coming, his friends asked him, what was he going to do after the war? And he said, I'm going to return to England and build a cathedral. Now, they must have thought he was mad, because the latest cathedral that had been built was St. Paul's Cathedral some 350 years ago. The man's name was Basil Spence, and before the war he'd been an architect. And in 1950, he entered a competition and won the commission to build Coventry Cathedral, which was completed in 1962. And that cathedral stands as a sign and a symbol of hope, standing as it does in the midst of the ruined medieval cathedral that was destroyed with much of Coventry in the bombing raids earlier in the war. A remarkable symbol of hope and of reconciliation, and it stands there today with that message of hope. And of course, Easter is the great season of hope. And I'm delighted for those who, when I was a young man, brought the gospel to me, shared their faith with me, and helped me to understand what it meant to follow Jesus as my Lord and my Saviour. And one of the things that I read as a young man is this booklet, The Evidence of the Resurrection, which has been reprinted over and over again. It was written by Sir Norman Anderson, who was a very distinguished lawyer. When he was at Cambridge, he got a triple first in law. He went into the army, and when he came out, he pursued his law career. He was knighted, he was a Queen's Counsel, and he ended his role as the Director of Advanced Legal Studies at London University. And he wrote this book, The Evidence of the Resurrection, setting out reasons in Scripture why the resurrection is true and why the resurrection is such an important and transforming message for all the world today. He had a son called Hugh, and Hugh was following in his father's footsteps. He too went to Cambridge to read law, and he was a brilliant debater and was president of the Cambridge Union. But very sadly, he had cancer and he died when he was 21. 5 days later, Sir Norman Anderson was doing the Thought for the Day on BBC Radio. He chose to speak about resurrection, and he said, I will stake my life on the resurrection. And so too did my son. He knew he had cancer, he knew he was dying, and his last words were, and I'm going to be with the Lord. And on radio, Sir Norman Anderson said, and I know that he was not mistaken. Because Easter is a season of hope. And it shares with us that great message of Christ, who was died and who rose again from the dead to bring us life everlasting. There are a number of themes that we could think about as we come to Easter. Let me just choose three words for us to think about: joy and peace and purpose. Like me, many of you may well have travelled in other countries around the world, and perhaps some of you have been fortunate enough to go to Zambia and to experience the joyful life and joyful witness and joyful worship of our brothers and sisters there. And right across the world, there was a great sense of joy in the resurrection. And many people around the world today will be celebrating joyfully and wonderfully as they remember that Christ is risen from the dead. As we think about the joy that reverberates around the world today, we're also aware that we as Christians, as followers of Christ, need to be joyful, need to be grateful, need to be thankful, and we need to celebrate the wonderful good news of Jesus Christ risen from the dead. Joy and peace. I think this Easter we're aware, perhaps more than any other year, just of all the challenges that we faced in this past year, the challenges that come to us and everyone in the world in different ways, through the coronavirus. And we know, sadly and tragically, many have had the virus, many have been in hospital, and we've been shocked by the number of people who have died and those who mourn. Many, many others are worried about their jobs, or they've been made unemployment. They're worried about how they can feed their families, or they're worried about family who they've not been able to see, perhaps for such a long time, or they themselves feel lonely and isolated. But even in the midst of all the challenges that we have faced, there are some wonderful signs of hope. Communities have come together to help and support each other, to visit those who are isolated, to serve food banks, and to serve in many different ways. There's been a new spirit of people coming together and working together. And then, of course, there's been the wonderful work of volunteers, collecting medicine, visiting people, caring for people who are lonely and isolated. Only this morning I had my first COVID jab, and there were volunteers in a very cold and windy car park, full of joy, delighted to serve other people. And then, of course, there's been the dedicated, the faithful and the selfless service of our workers, key workers, those in the national health and care workers, those who are key workers, those in our schools. The list goes on and on of people who have so given themselves selflessly to serve others and serve our communities. There is much that we give thanks for, even in the midst of the challenges of COVID, much to give us hope. And then purpose. The resurrection gives us a purpose as we understand that Jesus Christ has risen for us and that new life is possible, that we can be transformed by his love and by his Holy Spirit. On that first Easter day, the women who went to the tomb were fearful, they were sad, they felt isolated, they were vulnerable. And yet when they met Jesus, their lives were changed and transformed. And Jesus said to Mary Magdalene, "Now go and tell my disciples that I am risen from the dead." And that message of going comes to us today, comes down the centuries. And our Diocesan mission statement reminds us that our calling is, by the grace of God and with the grace of God, to be those who seek to live and tell the story of Jesus and to share with others the good news that Christ has risen from the dead. The Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. May God bless you this Easter and always. Amen.
Let us pray. Holy and everlasting God, on this Easter day, we give you thanks for the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead. In him, light triumphs over darkness, life triumphs over death. In him is our hope and the promise of eternal life. We pray for those who preach the gospel, and for all who seek to lead others to the risen Lord, and especially for Bishop Peter. For all who teach of our Lord's forgiveness, and for all who have their hope set on eternal life, that we may all rejoice in the power of the risen Lord. Amen. Lord God, Creator of the world, may we hear Jesus' voice, which says, "Peace be with you." May your peace begin in our hearts and in our homes. May it grow in our communities and reach out into the whole world. We remember today those places where peace is lacking, where conflict is rife. In particular today, we pray for Myanmar. Lord, may your peace come to all places of tension and dispute. We ask this in the name of your Son, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Almighty God, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, we ask your blessing on our Queen, Queen Elizabeth, and all the royal family. May they know your love and care in their daily lives. We pray too for our families and our friends, our loved ones and our neighbours, that in this time of COVID pandemic, we may reflect your unconditional love in supporting one another, and especially those who are alone and without others to be with them. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord Jesus, healer of the sick, we pray for all those who weep today, those newly separated from loved ones, all who are caught up in sorrow or in sickness, or who are feeling heavy-hearted. We pray too for those who are stricken with COVID-19 or who are suffering as a result of the virus. We give thanks for the coronavirus vaccine and for all healthcare and key workers who help and support us day by day. Lord, give them your strength and courage as they continue to look after those in their care. We remember all those who mourn the loss of a loved one, Lord, wipe away all tears from their eyes, that they may see you and know eternal life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. O God, whose nature and property is ever to have mercy and to forgive, receive our humble petitions, and though we be tied and bound with the chains of our sins, yet let the pitifulness of thy great mercy loose us, for the honour of Jesus Christ, our mediator and advocate. Amen.
Passes all understanding. Keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst us and remain with us always. Amen.